Praise the Lord. Come on, we can do better than that. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. For he's worthy to be praised. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, our God is worthy. Anybody beside me this morning know that he's worthy? If he woke you up this morning, he's worthy. If he's healed your body, he's worthy. If he's brought you from a mighty long way, he's worthy. My God is worthy of all praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're certainly, certainly thanking God for this opportunity this morning. I'm acknowledging God as the head of my life. And to his son, Jesus the Christ, who paid the ultimate sacrifice to die on an old rugged cross for all of our sins. But one thing a preacher told me one time, don't leave him there. He was buried for 3 long days, but early that Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hand. Hallelujah. That ought to be shouting right here for somebody to know that he still yet has all power in his hand. Hallelujah. We certainly, certainly honor the angel of this house, Pastor Matthew, my pastor, as well as your pastor. Amen, somebody. Amen. And to all of the ministers, the deacons, all of the trustees there in their respective place, to these great musicians, amen. Just awesome. Hallelujah. I do want to acknowledge Deacon Lanham, I'm glad to see him this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. How many know God is still a miracle worker? Hallelujah. When folks thought it was all over, God had the last say in it all. Amen. So it's certainly, certainly good to see him this morning. And I do want to acknowledge my extended church family. Hallelujah, church, for all of God's people, Bishop Nelson, Pastor Nelson, Pastor Burton, who took the time out this morning and did not consider it robbery to come on this side of the Jordan and to be able to worship with us this morning here at Pine Grove Baptist Church. Amen. And to my lovely wife, everybody know pretty much who she is. Amen. Amen. Sister Augurson. Hallelujah. Some say, I heard someone say one time before that her maiden name is White, but when she married me, she got rid of her maiden name. So I pretty much, amen, somebody. Make us two, make us one, amen, amen. Try not to trouble you too long, but there is a word from the Lord. If you have your Bibles, and I believe this prophet's going to be on the screen, I promise you, all of this technology sometimes just amazes me when I come over to Pine Grove. Y'all know y'all pastor is if the truth be told, like Inspector Gadget, he always has something. Amen, somebody. So our passage of scripture this morning will be coming from Matthew, the 14th chapter, Matthew's the 14th chapter. Starting at verse number 25, I'll be reading from the King James Version, Matthew chapter 14, verse number 25. If you don't mind, those of you that are able, we're going to ask you to rest upon your feet as we honor the word of God this morning. Amen. Amen. Let us read. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus came unto them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit," and they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." And Peter, somebody say Peter, answered and said, "Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water." And he said, Jesus now said, come. And when Peter was down of the ship, walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink. And he cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately, somebody say immediately. Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore did thou doubt? Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, we come down this hour again to say thank you for this opportunity once again to stand before these thy people. Thank you, dear God, for you've allowed me this opportunity. We ask you, dear God, to allow hearts to be receptive. Open our ears and eyes and understanding to your word. Now, we ask, dear God, to allow the words of my mouth and the meditation of your heart, of my heart, to be acceptable in thy sight, O God, for you are my strength and my redeemer. And the people of God said, amen, amen, amen. You may your seat in the presence of the Lord. This morning, for a few minutes, I want to talk to you from this perspective or this thought: distractions in the midst of the storm. We find, my brothers and sisters, when Jesus had finished all of his daily activities of feeding the 5,000, he sends the disciples over to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. He sends his disciples before him, and as they were crossing over to the other side, at some point of the night, they began to encounter a storm. Now, mind you, this was no ordinary or no typical storm. In other words, there was a different type of disturbance on the water, and Jesus shows up in the midst of the storm and causes peace to be still. I can get happy right there, because when Jesus shows up, something has to change. When Jesus shows up, all troubles have to cease. Often in life, my brothers and sisters, storms happen suddenly with little or no warning, and sometimes life-threatening. Many of us, the truth be told, at some point in our life, we have either been in a storm, coming out of a storm, or it's a storm heading our way. But I come to encourage you this morning to, just to tell you, don't get distracted in the storms of life. The reason why I'm saying it, because your very breakthrough, your very miracle could very well be hidden in the eye of your storm. You, in other words, you have to find that place in God where you can rest in his peace, that peace that only God can give, that peace that we know according to the Bible that surpasses all understanding. One thing that we found out about God, that when we've gone through this journey of life, that God knows all and God sees all. Can I get a witness? Meteorological studies have shown that the eye of the storm, my brothers and sisters, is the calmest place in the storm. Because most of your troubles, most of the chaos, and most of the confusion that you're dealing with is coming from the outside. I wish I had a witness in here. When there's trouble all around you, you have to find that place of peace while you're going through your stormy situation. One thing that we must understand this morning is that there are many types of storms, and we all can be faced with in this life. As a matter of fact, Wednesday night we talked about one individual in the Bible by the name of Jonah, and Jonah was faced with a storm. And Jonah was faced with a storm because of his disobedience. Am I right about it? Jonah's storm was a storm of correction. In other words, he spent 3 days, the Bible says, in the belly of a great fish. Someone once said, from a theological standpoint, that he stayed in the belly of the whale for 3-day seminar called Whale Belly Theology. I wish I had a witness in here. Someone once said that he was in there in the belly of the whale for 3 days saying, "Yes, Lord, send me, I go." Anybody got a yes in your spirit this morning? Our text this morning, the disciples were faced with a different type of storm. And their storm was a storm of perfection. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying that in this storm that they was faced with was to teach them and to grow them in their relationship with Jesus. In other words, every storm that you and I encounter is not meant to destroy you. Can I get a witness? There are some storms that happen in your life that has come to make you strong. I wish I had some church folk here. If you've ever been through a storm in your life and you come out unscathed, but it made you stronger in the Lord. And it's amazing the things that one will go through to mature and to develop their submission to the Word of God. I know it's easier said than done sometimes. Am I right about it? But no matter what storm you're faced with in this life, you're going to have some trials and tribulations. You know the saying, must Jesus bear this cross alone and all the world go free? There is a cross for everyone, a cross for you and a cross for me. In other words, simply saying that in this life some rain must fall. Every day the sun is not going to shine. Can I get a witness in here? And sometime when it rains, it pours. Oh, I wish I know some folk in here have experienced it. And you begin to recite that riddle, rain, rain, go away. Come again another day. Can I get a witness? And it very well may be something physical or mentally, emotional, even financial, and there may be a storm of spirituality, and the list goes on. But you got to remember this: as long as you're in the boat with Jesus, you're safer in the will of God. I heard the songwriter say that the safest place in the whole wide world is in the will of God. And I'm wondering this morning as I look out among you, is there anybody in here that will testify that no matter what I've had to go through in my life, I'm still in the will of God? Hallelujah. Sometimes up and sometimes down. Now, sometimes I feel as though I'm level to the ground, but one thing that I can rest assured that I am in the will of God. Someone in here this morning may be ready to throw in the towel, Digger Green. In other words, they are ready to jump ship because they're being tossed to and fro by the winds and the waves of life. And one thing that we have to understand is that God understands that the storms of life can be very challenging. And the truth be told, all of us who have encountered certain storms find ourselves struggling when we are going through. But while you're going through, can I suggest to you this morning that you make a commitment to hold on a little while longer, to hold on to God's unchanging hand, to hold on while you're going through and stay in the boat with Jesus. Too often, my brothers and sisters, we are too quick to jump ship. Why? When it doesn't seem favorable in our life. Not realizing that if we just look unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, if we just look unto him, Dry land is just ahead. I wish I had a witness in here. Sometimes when we are going through a stormy situation, sometimes we become unstable because the sea is foaming at the mouth and the winds of life are raging. But you have to understand that when you become unstable, this is when the devil begins to launch his attack. And he start picking on you. Anybody ever felt like they've been picked on? You become, the devil then becomes the main attraction in the midst of your storm. Now he becomes the center of your attention. And that's when you feel like you're being picked out to be picked on. Now everything is competing against God for your attention. Turn on the TV. There's some things that trying to draw your attention away from God. I wish I had some church folk in here. Now it's competing for your attention. Because number one, the devil knows that your breakthrough. He knows that your miracle. He knows that you're next in line for a blessing. Anybody can say to the neighbor next to you, all you got to do is just say, I'm next. I'm next in line. And I come to let somebody know this morning that the devil is a liar, that we have victory in Jesus. Anybody got victory? If you got victory, say yeah. The Bible reminds us that there's no weapon formed against us as shall prosper. It may form, but it shall not prosper. Yeah. The Bible, the word of God reminds us that when the enemy comes in like a flood, it gets God's attention. And God lifts up a standard against it. Am I right about it? In other words, don't let the devil, don't let the enemy snatch your attention away from God and cause you to lose or take your focus off the one who can keep you from falling. You ought to look at somebody and tell them, don't jump ship. Because the storm is about to pass over. What am I saying to you? What I'm saying is that it's safer in the boat in the will of God than those who are on dry land outside of the will of God. In our text, Peter says, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come. I don't know. Perhaps you may have seen it a little different, but I don't know. Perhaps Peter was testing Jesus when he said, if it be you, come. Remember the Bible said that when they saw him, he looked like a ghost. He looked like a spirit. We did read that, right? But maybe while Peter perhaps was testing Jesus, Jesus was testing Peter. Oh, I wish I had some witnesses. Anybody in here ever felt like God is testing you, that he allow you to go through some things and knowing that all the time that if you persevere that he will bring you through it? Sometimes in life, things are not always what they look like. Jesus said, come. And Peter steps out of the boat and he began to walk on the water. Peter started out with good intentions. Am I right about it? He started out with good intentions. And all of us that are sitting here this morning under the sound of my voice, all of us have started out with some good intentions. Am I right about it? And sometimes while your intentions are good, your faith begins to get shaken along the way. And just because your faith begins to be shaken does not necessarily mean that you have failed. One thing that we do know about Peter, that he may have acted out on impulse. But one thing that when you read the text, that I found out about Peter. Peter had enough faith to go toward Jesus. In other words, Peter was not concerned about what someone else thought about it. He was not concerned about what the others in the boat may have said. And I believe, the truth be told, sometimes you just have to step out all by yourself, despite what is going on around you. Church of old would say, if I have to go, I'll go by myself. I believe even in the midst of our storms, my brothers and sisters, Jesus calls us to come. To come closer to him so we can become, so that he can become our life vest. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying the life vest is to help us to stay afloat. Can I get a witness in here? Not only that, he wants to be our lifeline to pull us in when we are too far out. Oh, I wish I had somebody in here that has gone through this life, gone through this journey, and you feel like there was a time you begin to sink. He calls us to help us to become more like him. Can I get a witness? He calls us, and you and I, he calls us, and he tells us to go. But how many know he calls us to come before he tells us to go? He calls us to help us to be more like him, calling us to spiritual perfection. None of us have arrived yet. If you arrive, you're in the wrong place this morning. But yet there are still some who are kicking against the prick. But before Peter walks out on the water, can I tell you that he stepped out on faith and he walked out on the word? He stepped out on faith and he walked out on the word come. This word come, my brothers and sisters, was Jesus' favorite word that he used throughout his ministry. Come unto me, all who labor and who are heavy laden. And maybe today, my brothers and sisters, the Lord is calling you to come. To step out of the boat into a new place in him. Maybe God is trying to reveal a new revelation in your life, but you are simply being distracted. Distracted by deception, distracted by pride, distracted by selfishness, distracted by fame, vain glory, distracted by unbelief. But when Peter, y'all read it, saw the wind boisterous, the Bible said he became afraid. And in that time that he began to doubt, and the Bible says he started or he began to sink. Am I in the book? Now I don't know if it was all about Peter walking on the water. I don't know if it was all about him taking his eyes off of Jesus. If I could be honest with you this morning, I believe that for a moment, Peter simply got distracted by the force of the wind and lost sight of his miracle. Can I tell you, in life sometimes, in a moment, we can be distracted. Okay. Let's be driving down 520. And all of a sudden, someone calls their car to swing over in front of you. You get distracted. And then you do some things you ought to not. You say some things. Oh, y'all ain't gonna help me this morning. But the Bible lets us know in 2 Corinthians 5:7, it says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. Wish I had a witness. But I like Peter. Peter still had enough faith even while he was going down to look up and say, Lord, save me. Because he knew that his miracle was still right there in front of him. He still looked up to Jesus because he knew that's where his help come from. Anybody know that when you're down, all you got to do is look up knowing that your help is near. When you can't depend on no one else, you can always depend on Jesus. That's why I love the man Jesus. Anybody in here love him like I love him? I love him because Hebrews 13:5 reminds me that he'll never leave me, neither will he forsake me. Yeah, sometimes the storms of life, listen to me, will put you in a position where you feel as though you've sunk so low that you muster up as much strength as you possibly can just to reach up and touch bottom. Anybody ever been low? Sometimes God seems so far away. But we know that he's ever so close. Distractions in the midst of the storm. As I get ready to close and hasten to my seat, Jesus now, knowing that Peter is beginning to sink, Jesus now began to flex his muscles. He knew Peter had gotten weak. He knew that in that moment, Peter was desperate, looking for a way out. Come on, musician. I don't know about you this morning, but I've been desperate a few times in my life. Is there anybody in here this morning? Have you ever been desperate? Listen, when you started getting weak, and you started getting desperate in those moments of storms in your life, and you start looking for a way out, I come to let you know, don't get distracted in the midst of your storm. All you have to do is look up and call on the name of Jesus. Luke reminds us in Acts 4:12, he says, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Oh, I wish I had a church in here. Apostle Paul says in Romans 10:13, he says, whosoever call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Not that you might be saved, but you shall be saved. Anybody had to call on him lately? Anybody had to call on him when there was a wayward child? Anybody had to call on him when you needed healing in your body? Anybody had to call on him when there was a bill that needed to be paid? Anybody had to call on him when you didn't know which way to go? You didn't want to go left. Two didn't want to go right. Didn't want to go back, but you were too afraid to go forward. Jeremiah 33:3 says, call unto me, and I'll show you great and mighty things that you know not. Anybody understand? Ken Nugent was not the first one to make that slogan. In other words, when Jeremiah, the Lord said, call me, one call, that's all. I wish I had a witness in here. That the name of Jesus is a name that calms all of my fears. It's the name that helps me to weather any storm. That at the name of Jesus, the Bible says that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. And anybody know that there's power in the name of Jesus? Anybody got power? Say it. there, Jesus tells his disciples, he says, be of good cheer. Why did he say that, Pastor? He said it because I am is right there in the midst of their storm. What are you saying? He was letting them know that whatever they needed, I am is available. He said, I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am your deliverer. I am your provider. I am your healer. I am your way maker, your miracle worker. I am a light in a dark place. And I heard someone say, even he's Big Mama walking cane. I wish I had some folk in here. I am everything that you need in the midst of your storm. Anybody know that the name of Jesus is like no other? You can call on the doctor. You can call on the lawyer. You can call on this and that. But when you call on the name of Jesus, you handcuffed him to come to your rescue. Anybody in here know that he'll come? But one thing we found out, he may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. Anybody know he's an on-time God? When you think that he's giving up on you, he's always on time. When you think that you don't have nothing left in your life, he's always on time. If you know he's on time, say yeah, say yeah, say yeah. Nobody like the Lord. Nobody would do you like the Lord. So I come to let you know this morning, don't get distracted. The issues of life in the midst of your storm. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Jesus didn't get distracted when he knew what his purpose was. He didn't get distracted by all the folks who plotted against him. He didn't get distracted by being lied on and talked about. He didn't get distracted knowing that his ultimate destination was Calvary's cross. I don't know about you this morning, but I'm so glad that he didn't get distracted. Anybody know that he hung there and he died buried in a borrowed tomb? I'm so glad that the story didn't end. Right there, he got up with all power in his hand. He got up, my brothers and sisters, with all power in his hand. And the Bible says that same power he's given to us. I'm just wondering this morning, do you really have power? Do you have power to forgive your neighbors? Do you have power to love your enemy? Do you have power to give and not expect anything in return? Do you have that power? Listen, I don't know.